All are doing well. I am Sakshi Priya, HR Manager at AirQ's Aviation Private Limited Company. Welcomes you all in today's productive webinar. Today, we all are gathered here for a webinar, and the topic of the webinar is Aviation Industry, Aviation Jobs and Insight. This productive webinar is hosted by our guest speaker, Ms. Kirti Vilori. So, we welcome you all on behalf of AirQ's Aviation Private Limited Company. Now, over to you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thanks, Sakshi. Thanks for this introduction. And welcome, everybody. And good afternoon to each one of you. Let me just share my screen so that everybody is aware as to what's going on. All right, so a very good afternoon to every one of you. Today, I will be talking to you about aviation jobs and give you an insight as to what are the various options and opportunities which are available in the aviation industry, other than that of pilots and cabin crew. So by far, what happens is that every time you think of aviation, every time you think of an industry or an airline company, the only jobs or the only roles that most of us think of is that of a pilot, is that of a cabin crew, or perhaps somebody, in the ticketing industry, who does something on ticketing and gets into become a ground staff or becomes somebody who handles counters and reservations, right? So these are the only three options normally think of whenever we think of aviation. So today here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show or give you a little bit of an insight as to that there are other options also available. There are other opportunities that you can explore in order to get into aviation. So that is going to be the topic of today. Now, most of the times, what happens is that whenever you attend a webinar or whenever you attend any kind of a presentation, you obviously want to take some take homes, right? You want to have some sort of knowledge or some sort of information that you want to take home with you. What have you learned in this particular webinar and what have you understood in this particular webinar is what you would normally be interested in, right? So in such a case, this is what exactly what it means is what's in it for me. So what's in this webinar or what's in this presentation for you? What is going to be the take home for you after we finish this webinar? What are the objectives of this is we'll discuss that. So the objectives are, one second, yeah. So yes, the objectives are that we will enlist the various departments in an aviation organization. So there are various departments in the aviation organization, which we probably are not even aware of, right? And within these departments, there are various roles which are available for you that you can probably explore, right? So first, we'll take a step-by-step process and we will look at what are the various departments which are available in the aviation organization. Then we will explore the professional possibilities in each of these departments. What are the various roles that you can take up in these departments? What are the different options that are available for you in these departments? And thereafter, once we've defined the professional possibilities, we will discuss the qualification and the training requirements for each of these possibilities, each of these professional possibilities that we have discussed. Okay. At any given point of time, if you have any questions, you may please feel free to ask me. There is a chat option available on the Zoom ID. So if there's any question, please feel free to type in your question. And as far as possible, I will definitely try to, solve that query or answer that query in the best possible manner. Correct? So at this point of time, how many do we have? We have about 12 participants. Okay. So before I move on to actually discussing and, talking a lot about what exactly is there in the aviation organization, I have a question for all of you, right? You have a chat box in your, on the Zoom ID. So I would like you to think for about 2-3 minutes and tell me, what do you think are the various options or professional options that are available in the aviation industry? Don't talk about pilots and don't talk about cabin crew and ticketing, because like I said, this webinar does not specify or does not concentrate on those roles. we are primarily talking about roles which are over and above pilots and cabin crew. So, you know, think about it. And what I suggest is just give a few options, what you think are the options available. So I'll give you some time, 2-3 minutes, maybe. By the way, there are no right or wrong answers. So please feel free to write whatever comes to your mind. And don't worry, I will not pick you up and ask you to speak about it. So don't have to worry about that as well. Just whatever you think is right, please go ahead and write. For all the participants who've just come in new, the question is available on the screen for you. So what, according to you, are the various options available in aviation industry? What kind of job roles that you can take up in the aviation industry, according to you? Could be anything, could be in various departments, could be in various teams. Don't write pilots and cabin crew, because again, like I said, this is not something that we want to, this webinar is not about pilots and cabin crew. Great, so we have some answers. We have, yes, very nice. I'll give you some more time, maybe another minute. Great. So we have a few answers now. So we have, yes, somebody has mentioned there are jobs related to HR department. Absolutely correct. Then we have pilots, of course. AMEs, yes, very good. Air hostess, definitely. Loaders, HR, marketing, super. Then tourism sector in the aviation industry. Yes, in which way the industry help in HR sector? Yes, we will discuss that as well. Operation control center, absolutely. Finance, catering, great. So it seems like you guys are pretty much aware, and you are quite aware of the various options and possibilities that are available in the aviation industry. Most of you have set the options or said have spoken about the possibilities, which I will be talking in the next slide. So super great, thanks for your participation. That's very, very nice. So exactly this is what we are going to discuss over here. So we will talk about the departments in aviation industry. So absolutely right. One of you mentioned sales and marketing. Exactly. There is a department called as sales and marketing, which is available in someone says vacation centers in aviation sector. Correct, absolutely. So you have sales and marketing team, which is available in the aviation department, right? So that's another, in the aviation organization, there's a sales and marketing team. There are public relations team. We'll discuss about each of these teams and each of these departments in detail over the next few slides. But yes, this is exactly what you guys have also mentioned. Finance, absolutely. That's one of you mentioned finance, right? Human resources, which is a pivotal organization or which is a pivotal department in any of these organizations, correct? And thereafter, one of the most important and one of the larger departments in the aviation sector is flight operations. In flight operations, you have various other sub-teams. You have operations, you have training, you have licensing, you have flight dispatch, engineering, so many of these other subcategories. So what we will do is we will now look at, we'll look into each of these departments, and we will now see as to Sorry, one second. Let me see. I see somebody else also writing something. So guys, okay. So we can stop with the points now, which is very, very good. So this is what we will now discuss in the in each of these slides. Going forward, in each of these slides, we will talk about each of these teams, and we will look at the various options which are probably available in each of these teams. How can you probably gain experience? What can you do in order to train yourselves to enter into any of these departments? And where, what are the various courses which are available for each of these teams, right? So we'll discuss each one of them now, okay? Let's look at sales and marketing and public relations, right? Now, what exactly does the aviation sales and marketing team do, or what does the public relations team in the sales and marketing team, in the sales and public relations team in the aviation industry do, right? Now, like most of the other businesses, what happens is that even the airline industry, it depends on its marketing teams, it depends on its sales and PR and advertisement teams to come up with campaigns, to come up with advertisements to attract passengers and to attract new revenue, number one. And number two, also to make sure that the number or that the existing passengers, they keep coming back to us, right? Now, how do they do that? They would probably do that with, you must have seen on social media posts, you may have seen airline social media pages, like which is on Instagram or on Facebook. You will see these various ads that come up where they talk about that, okay, they're flying to a new destination. Maybe they have festive offers coming up. So who does all of that? Who makes all these videos? Who makes all these flyers? Who makes these flyers for the newspapers? It is all done by the sales and marketing team, right? Similarly, what does the public relations team do? Public relations team ensures that the there is a good rapport between us as the airline and also between the journalists or with the publishing houses or with, for example, there may be certain airlines which talk about the on-time performance data of, on-time performance data of certain airlines is published by various publishing houses like Economic Times, like Business Times. That may be right information, that may be correct information, or that may be sometimes incorrect information. Who gives all that information to them? Who provides that kind of data and who becomes the mediator is the public relations team. Anything which is pertaining to social media, anything, any complaints that you make in the social media, is dealt with the public relations team. That is what the public relations team and the sales and marketing team does, because it is primarily required to keep the existing passengers coming back and for new passengers or to attract new customers and to attract new revenue, right? So what is it that they exactly do? They create various ads and marketing campaigns to attract revenue and passengers. Now, what can you do in order to probably get into this kind of a role, right? Most of the times, some sort of a college degree in the field of marketing, in the field of public relations, in the field of communications, that is something which is, that is the kind of profile that the, airline industries will look for in this particular department, right? If you have, if you've done a degree in mass communication, or if you have some sort of a degree in, marketing, or if you have experience in sales, this is what would actually count, correct? Now, also, because it has got to do with rapport, it has got to do with kind of a communication with the various teams, it is extremely important that you have a good knowledge of spoken English. You have good knowledge of business English, and you have excellent communication skills. So if there are some of you who you think that you have that kind of experience, but probably you're still not getting a job, is probably because your communication skills are not the best. So you may enroll yourselves in some English spoken classes, etc., in order to ensure that your communication skills become extremely good and they become honed, right? So that is one of the things, also one of the requirements of the sales and marketing team. Now, what can you do? Where can you learn these courses? There are a lot of courses which are available. These courses there are a few diploma courses which are available on the IATA website. So you can see it's www.iata.org. You have aviation management courses, you have aviation sales courses which are available on this website. So you can always go and enroll yourself on these courses and get a sort of a diploma, right? So that's about sales and marketing and public relations. Let's go to the next department, which is our finance department, right? Now, you know, even aviation organization works as any other organization. So for example, in an IT, in the IT industry, not all IT organizations have, not all IT organizations deal only with IT products and IT services. You know, they have various other functions in the organization that actually work at the back end for the smooth operations of the organization and of the industry. So it has a similar concept with the aviation organization as well. Even though, yes, the main fundamentals of that organization is aircraft, is flying, is pilots and cabin crew. But at the same time, there are a lot of other teams which work at the back end that actually help you or that actually help in the smooth operations of that particular airline, right? So some of these, so similarly, in that case, just as finance team is available in various organizations, similarly, in the aviation organization also, there is finance team available. Of course, the finance team is a little different in the aviation organization as compared to maybe, you know, another organization. Because here you are talking primarily about aspects pertaining to aviation, correct? So what does the finance team in the aviation organization do? Now, what happens is airlines need to deal with various costs, right? If a new airline comes in, there are various costs such as startup costs that they have to deal with. When the airline is up and running, they have to deal with something called as operating costs, right? What are these operating costs? For example, for the aircraft to fly, you need fuel, right? So there is there are fuel costs. You have to ensure that the aircraft is maintained in a correct way. So there are aircraft maintenance costs. You have to ensure that all the pilots and the cabin crew and all other employees that are working in the organization are trained and are you know, equipped with the correct skill set in order to ensure that the flying happens smoothly. Those are employee costs, right? So there are various costs like operating costs. Then similarly, you have depreciation costs. Like for example, if you take any machine, it depreciates over time, right? It depreciates over a certain number. The value of it reduces over a certain number of days or years or time, right? That is your depreciation cost. Similarly, with an aircraft, it is also a machine. There are spares that kind of become outdated, and there are those costs that have also to be taken care of by the finance team. So there are various costs that the finance team has to look into. Other than that, of course, there are various other factors, such as they have to deal with the budgeting expenses of the entire airline, right? They have to look at the allowances bit of maybe the pilots and the cabin crew. So there are various other factors that are also pertaining to the finance team. And that is what the members or the personnel who are working in the aviation finance team deal with, right? So if your interest is in numbers, or if your interest is in finance, or trying to, you know, understand the cost perspective of certain things, this is the role for you. And this is something that you should pursue. All right. What exactly, again, is the training that is required? Once again, it is normally a college degree. So if you've done any kind of a course, if you have done a BBA course, or if you've done an MBA course specialized in finance, that is something which would be helpful for you. If you've done chartered accountancy, right? If you're a chartered accountant, those are also the profiles which the aviation industry would probably look for in this particular role, right? So these are the most sought after, you know, education qualifications for this role. What are the various courses which are available? Again, if you go onto the IATA website, there are specific aviation finance diploma courses which are available, right? So those are, again, those are courses which you can enroll for, you can go through them, right? Students of chartered accountancy, finance management, mostly they have an upper hand, because anybody who has experience in finance and understands the basics and the fundamentals of it is somebody who would be preferred for in this particular role, okay? Then comes human resources. Somebody in the chat also mentioned human resources. So yes, this is one of the pivotal teams in any organization. Any organization, any type of organization, whether it is aviation, IT, advertising, anywhere, you will always have, even a small basic, small industry would have something, would have a human resource team, right? So similarly, in the aviation organization also, you have a human resources team. What does the human resource personnel in the aviation organization do? Now, depending on the position, an HR person may be responsible for checking backgrounds and qualification requirements of candidates, hiring of new staff, airline staff, ground staff, there's pilots, there's cabin crew, you know, hiring of those staff, processing benefits and other paperwork as well. So this is primarily what they do. Now, it is a little different from that of the other human resource personnel is because this human resource personnel is going to be involved in selecting candidates which are pilots or selecting candidates which are cabin crew. Normally, it is expected for this human resource personnel to have a little bit of knowledge about the regulations and the requirements for pilots or cabin crew. Mostly, you have like a recruitment team that probably looks into this, and they will probably look at all the qualification requirements of the pilots, whether they're meeting the requirements or not. So they're supposed to have certain licenses. They're supposed to have certain number of hours in order to even apply for an organization in the aviation industry. Now, those requirements or those qualification requirements are something that you probably would have an upper hand if you have knowledge of it, because that is something that you're primarily going to be dealing with. You would be dealing with recruiting pilots. You would be dealing with recruiting cabin crew, right? You would be dealing with a lot of these people who are in that particular role or who have studied that kind of education, right? So it is important sometimes, most of the times in a human resource personnel who is in the aviation industry is expected to know or expected to have a certain amount of knowledge with regards to this kind of selection. What kind of training can you do? So again, there are various factors when it comes to human resources. Now, most of the times a college degree with human resource as a specialization works. It's always very good. Even a normal graduate probably can join in as an intern as in the human resources team of the aviation industry and probably learn on the job. There are a lot of people who do maybe, BBA in aviation management, and they work as interns in the aviation organization and probably get experience out of that and eventually get absorbed in the airlines. So that could also be a possibility. But of course, if you have a degree in HR, it always makes, it always gives you an upper hand. Now, what are certain things which a candidate should have? They should obviously have excellent communication skills, because you have to understand you are the middleman or you are the mediator between the candidate and between the organization. Therefore, it is required that you have empathy, you have those skills such as empathy, you have skills like good communication skills in order to have that kind of a rapport with the candidate as well as with your senior leadership. Right? You should be able to multitask and you have to be highly organized, because there will be times when you will have probably maybe, 100, 200 cabin crew applying, and you have to deal with all of them. You have to look at the profiles of each one of them and make sure that everything is proper, right? And that they're meeting all the regulatory requirements. So you've got to be very, very organized. These are the skill sets that are required for them, right? Again, also because, as an HR personnel, anywhere, whether it is in aviation or whether it is in any other organization, it's very important to honor confidentiality, because people are sharing some very important and confidential information with you, and it is important that you keep that with you, right? And like I said, most airlines normally like a certain working knowledge of the aviation industry in the HR candidates, but there are options available where you can probably intern in one of the HR teams in the aviation organization and get on the job. On the job training of it, right? Again, like I said, the airline may provide on the job training. Sometimes a certification is, like I said, is helpful. It's not necessarily essential. It is not something which is extremely mandatory, but yes, it always helps and it always puts you on the advantage. Okay. Now let's look at flight operations. Now, flight operations, like I said, in the flight operations, we said that we have various subcategories, right? We have subcategories such as operations. We have categories as training. There was operations, there was training, there was licensing, there was engineering, there was flight dispatch, right? So we spoke about, we wrote down that there are so many other subcategories in the flight operations team itself. So we'll talk a little bit about each one of them. Right. We'll talk about the operations bit later. So when we talk of operations, what does the operations team in the flight operations team does? It actually, as the word very easily suggests, it looks at or it overviews, it monitors, it tracks the operations of the aircraft on a daily basis. Operations of how does the aircraft operate? It operates when it flies from one place to the other. There have to be cabin crew and there have to be pilots on board and you need to have passengers. So on a day-to-day basis, what are the various activities and what are the monitoring that is required for the for the smooth operations of a particular airline is what the operations team does, right? Now, in again for operations, there are various other personnel that are required. There's cabin crew, there's pilots, there's AMEs. I did mention in the chat that there are AMEs and there are OCC and flight dispatch people. Absolutely. So we need to train them as well. So let's talk about what does training entail. Now, training entails, when we talk of flight operations and we speak of training, what does training entail? It entails training for cabin crew. It entails training for pilots. It entails training for AMEs, for flight dispatchers. These are just a few broad ones that I'm talking about. All of these personnel, they are governed by our regulations, which is by the DGCA, that is Directorate General of Civil Aviation, right? DGCA mandates and lays down certain rules and regulations for each of these personnel, and you have to ensure that these personnel undergo this kind of training in order to continue their functions or to exercise their privileges as that particular role. So it is very important. So that's what training does. Training looks at the various requirements of training for each one of these roles and ensure that they're planned in a timely manner. That's what training does. Similarly, what does licensing entail? Now, licensing also, again, like I said, all pilots, cabin crew, in fact, even AMEs, that is aircraft maintenance engineers and flight dispatchers, all of us or the entire airline, they are governed by certain regulations of the country. For example, in the US, it is governed by FAA. In the Europe, it is governed by EASA. In UAE, it is governed by GCAA. In India, it is governed by DGCA. Right? So we as an airline, or for that matter, anybody in any airline in this organization, in the country, is governed by this organization called DGCA. Right? Now, what does DGCA do? DGCA lays down certain rules and regulations, which are called as civil aviation requirements, that is CAR, CARs. So DGCA lays down certain rules, DGCA lays down certain requirements and the training that is required for each one of these personnel, right? Also, there are certain licenses that each of these personnel need to maintain. Now, how do I maintain this license? You probably need to do training on a monthly, on a yearly basis, or on a 6-monthly basis, correct? Now, training takes care of the part that, okay, their training is completed. Licensing then takes care of the part that their licenses are current and valid, right? They will coordinate with DGCA, they will coordinate with the pilots and the personnel and ensure that all the licenses that are required mandatorily for each of these personnel to maintain and to operate an aircraft are compliant and are current. So that is what the licensing team does. These two teams are also, again, extremely important in flight operations team, because they are actually the ones who ensure that the personnel are current and they are valid to actually do their jobs. If their licensing or if their training is not current, or if it has not, or if it has expired, they can no longer exercise the privileges as a pilot or as an AME, and they will probably be grounded, right? And they will not be able to exercise the privileges. They will not be able to do the job till their license is renewed. Therefore, it is very important that the timely renewal, timely training is done for all of these personnel, okay? Now, like I said, in this particular webinar, we will not be talking of pilots and cabin crew, because that is something which I think everybody is very well aware of, and they've done a lot of research on that. And maybe we can talk about that in another webinar as to what are the requirements of becoming a pilot, or what are the requirements of becoming a cabin crew. You know, that is something that we can discuss in a later seminar or in a later webinar. How can you prepare yourself? That is not something which we will discuss here. We will discuss about some other aspects which are not pertaining to pilots and cabin crew. So one of the other very sought after job is that of an aircraft maintenance engineer. Now, what is an aircraft maintenance engineer? As the word very clearly suggests to you, it is an engineer. He or she is an engineer who is responsible for maintenance of the aircraft. That's exactly what the aircraft maintenance engineer does. An AME deals with the maintenance of the aircraft and its components. That's the job of the engineer, right? Now, normally, again, these are, like I said, all of these personnel are governed by licenses and training. So the AME's license is issued by the DGCA. It is valid in India as well as in overseas. So even if you have an AME's license in India, but you probably want to go to Vietnam and do a job, it would be valid, correct? As long as it is valid, maybe they will have a basic level of training that is required for them to understand the regulations of Vietnam, but at the same time, it will also remain valid. Okay, that's what the AMEs do. Now, what can I do in order to become an AME? What is your what are the various steps that you can do if you are interested in engineering and if you're interested in getting a role of an aircraft maintenance engineer? So to get the AME license, number one, so the first thing is before even applying for the aircraft entrance examination, so you've got to be, your qualification, you've got to be 10 plus 2, and you have physics and maths in your curriculum. So anybody who, so people who have done arts are not really eligible to apply for an AME entrance examination. You need to be 10 plus 2 and you need to have physics and maths, mathematics as your subjects. Once you've done that, you have to qualify for the AME entrance examination, right? So you have, there is an AME entrance exam. You Google it, you will have a lot of information that is available on the net on how to go about this AME entrance examination. You have to apply for it. And once you've cleared the AME entrance examination, you may take admission in any of these institutes, right? Just as any other engineering course, the duration of this course is about 4 years. In the 4 years, 2 years is what you do academically. And 2 years, you will do probably on-the-job training or you will do some sort of live training, right? In this 4 years of training, there are certain modules which are mandatorily, they have been dictated by the DGCA, right? So DGCA are conducted, there are certain modules that the DGCA says that they will conduct it. And those are mandatory, which you have to complete. Only once you clear all of this and only once the issuance of an AME license is done by the DGCA, would you become a licensed or a certified AME. Without the license of an AME, you cannot practice the privileges or you cannot become an AME, or you will not even be recruited or selected for the role of AME in any organization. So it is not like an HR or a finance or a sales and marketing job where you can probably do on the job training. Here you need to have specific qualification in order to even get into that airline, right? So you need to have that AME license, right? Now, I'll just give you a little bit of a brief about the AME license. Of course, this is a very broad overview. A lot of details are mentioned when you go on to, when you look into, you search, you do your research and you look into Google and find out the various, options or licenses which are available for you to become an AME, but I'll just give you a broad overview of what it is. Right? So there are various categories in which a candidate can procure the AME license. So there's category A, which allows you to work as a technician. Now, this is one of the basic levels of an AME. So where you start, where you probably work as a technician. Now the category or license category A is again further subcategorized into A1, A2, A3, and A4. As I very clearly mentioned, A1 is for jet engines, aircrafts with jet engines. A2 is for aircraft with piston engines. A3 is helicopter with jet engine, and A4 is helicopters with piston engine. So these are various subcategories. Once, if you get, let's say, if you've been given a license by the DGCA as an A3 level of AME, you can work as a technician on a helicopter which has a jet engine. You cannot work as a technician on a helicopter with a piston engine. So there are specific categories for each type of aircraft or helicopter that the AME can actually work on, right? Then you have the B1 category. This license is in the mechanical stream, which deals with the maintenance of engines, wings, and other components. And B2 is more on the electronics category or the avionics stream, which is related to electronic components in the aircraft, such as electrical systems, instrumental systems, radio navigation, just as a normal engineering course, right? You have a normal engineering course where you have mechanical engineering, you have chemical engineering, you have electronical engineering. Similarly, you have various categories in the aviation engineering as well, in the aircraft maintenance engineering, where you have B1, B2, A1, A2, A3 categories of licensing. So this is a very sought after role. This is something which is extremely pivotal in an organization in an aviation organization. AMEs are responsible for ensuring that the aircraft is in top notch condition, right? Before any aircraft takes off and after every aircraft lands, It is the AME's duty to ensure that all the components and everything is working properly. In fact, most of the times, not most of the times, as a process, the AMEs and the pilots always have a checklist that they probably fill in order to ensure that the aircraft is in proper order before taking off and even after landing. So if there is something, if you're very passionate about aircraft and if you probably cannot become a pilot or you cannot become a cabin crew and you really, really want to get into the aviation industry, this is also one of the very good roles that you can take up and in fact is a very well-paid job as well, right? So that's aircraft maintenance engineer. Let's go to another type of a role, which is called as a flight dispatcher, right? What does a flight dispatcher do? Again, as the word very specifically suggests, it is a person who is responsible for dispatching the flight. For dispatching the flight, what all do you need? You need to have a flight plan, right? You need to have a route from A to B as to what route, again, just like Google Maps. Like Google Maps tells you that you can take this particular route to move from destination A to B. Similarly, a flight dispatcher will say that, okay, if the flight wants to move from, or the aircraft wants to move from point A to point B, there is a certain flight plan that you have to take into consideration. Just as Google Maps takes into consideration the traffic, similarly, the flight dispatcher will look into considerations such as weather en route, whether it will look at the meteorological conditions, it will look at turbulence factors. All of these things will be taken into consideration and the flight dispatcher will create a flight plan and at the same time also be in contact with the pilots to ensure that the flight plan is being maintained. So that's what a flight dispatcher does. A flight dispatcher assists in planning flight paths, taking into account aircraft performance and loading. So even the aircraft performance and loading is taken into consideration. So what is the fuel efficiency of that particular aircraft? How much load can that particular aircraft take and what kind of route therefore I should suggest, right? So those are things that are taken into consideration. The en route winds, thunderstorm, turbulence forecasts, airspace restrictions, airport conditions. So all of these are taken into consideration to create the flight path or to create the flight plan, right? Dispatchers also provide a flight following service and advise pilots if conditions change. They usually work in the operations center of the airline. So I don't know if any one of you has seen the OCC of a particular airline. If you want, maybe later I can show you a picture of what the OCC looks like. Normally an operation control center, that's the OCC of an airline, is normally a dark room. It's a huge dark room and it has got screens all over. So that's what the OCC does, which talks about the aircraft plan and path of each and every flight path that that particular airline is taking. That's what the OCC looks like. I would probably show you a picture of it after the session is over, right? So that's what the flight dispatcher does. Again, if I want to become a flight dispatcher, what should I do? The candidate should have attained 21 years of age. Once again, you need to be 10 plus 2 and you need to have, again, from a recognized board or university, and you definitely need to have maths and physics and mathematics in your syllabus. That is, again, a prerequisite. Thereafter, once you become, you can enroll for a course as a flight dispatcher. Again, various courses are available in various organizations. In fact, airlines also provide these courses. Air India provides a flight dispatcher course. There are flight dispatcher courses which are offered by ATOs. When I say ATOs, it's airline training organizations such as CAE or FSTC. There are various other organizations and institutes that probably help you to enroll for a flight dispatcher course and become a flight dispatcher. Once you've enrolled, what is the duration of this training? The duration of this training is approximately 360 hours or 12 weeks of ground class, right? Once you've completed the ground classes, of course, there's an examination once again by the DGCA, right? If you successfully clear the DGCA examination, there is 90 days of on-the-job training, wherein you have to do in that on-the-job training, you have to at least do minimum of 5 hours of simulator sessions for observing flight deck operations. So what do I mean by simulator sessions? If you've seen a simulator, basically simulator is the cockpit of a particular aircraft that has been put in a particular place, right? Which is exactly, and it resembles the cockpit of a particular aircraft. So for example, you may have a 320 simulator, you may have a 737 simulator. These simulators are pertaining to a particular aircraft and they function exactly as that of an actual aircraft. So instead of them going and observing the operations or observing the cockpit operations in the aircraft or on a normal commercial flight, they're supposed to do 5 hours of simulator training. They're supposed to do observation sessions of the cockpit in the simulator. That's the requirement of a flight dispatcher. All right. Once again, where can I get these courses? There are various courses, like I said, which are available that provide you a diploma in flight dispatchers. Air India offers you such courses. Then there's also PRTOs and ATOs, which provide. So there are many other options. There are many institutes that probably provide you with these kind of dispatcher courses. So basically, as you can see that I've just touched upon few topics, which is AMEs, and I've touched upon a few topics of, probably sales and marketing and finance, etc. So as you can see that there are not just the roles which are pertaining to aviation industry, or the opportunities that are available in the aviation industry are not just pertaining to pilots and cabin crew and ticketing, right? You can explore a lot more. There are a lot of other things that you can do if you are really passionate about the aviation industry, if you really like the aviation industry, and you want to be a part of the aviation organization. There are various other opportunities that you can try. You can intern in various places and get that kind of experience. So it's not just pertaining to one particular role. And so to summarize, if we were to summarize what we actually learned today is, like I said, there are many options available in the aviation industry that you can explore professionally, loads of them. Not just pilots and cabin crew. Of course, pilots and cabin crew are one of the most pivotal roles in this organization because they're the faces of the airline. But if you can't, for some reason, if you can't get into this role of a pilot or of a cabin crew, there are various other options available, which you can probably get and you can explore as well. Each role, of course, has a specific qualification and a training requirement, which we discussed. Right. And depending on your capabilities and interests, you can explore and intern for various roles. So I would recommend, and I would, if any one of you is interested in, and I'm assuming most of you are interested in getting into the aviation organization, anything that you feel is, first figure out what your interest is, what according to you is your strength. And based on that, try and understand and see what is the particular role that you would want to actually get into. Right. So, thank you very much for your lovely time. And thanks for listening to me. We will just go through so now we are open to questions. Any questions that you have, you may please feel free to ask. You can put it in the chat box. I see some questions here. Let's just see some questions which are available over here. Yeah. So we have a question that says vacation centers and aviation sector integration with other logistic departments. What is the future of aviation sector domestically or internationally, role of aviation sector beyond travel? So to answer your question, what is the future of aviation sector? Well, we all know thanks to COVID, there has been a certain amount of, thanks to COVID-19, the travel sector has gotten impacted. We've had a little bit of an issue with regards to the travel sector. And it has been impacted terribly because of COVID 2019. However, having said that, so yes, there has been an impact. And at this point of time, it is not the best. It's not in its best stage. But having said that, I would also say that any upward age and how aviation sector is doing post COVID, exactly the same. I'll come to that. That's what we are discussing. So basically, yes, it has been impacted, as I said, because of the travel industry going through so many issues, and because aviation is primarily about travel and about passengers and about moving from one place to another, it has gotten impacted. The kind of vacation travels that used to happen previously have completely gone down. Now the travel has primarily become very need-based, right? It's no longer it's no longer vacation based per se. So yes, that has gotten affected. But having said that, I will also say this, that it is getting better. It is definitely getting better. Even today, if we look at it, after the COVID, once COVID-19 happened, if you are aware or if you're not aware of it, DGCA had said that all operations has to stop. So we had literally no flights happening for a good 2-3 months, which obviously had a great impact and a huge negative impact on all the aviation organizations in India, right? So it did create a lot of problems, and that's when a lot of people lost their jobs. We had salary cuts, all of that happened. But over the now last few months, the travel has started increasing. So now we are allowed to operate up to 42% of our fleet, of our previous operation. So for example, if previously in the last year, we used to have, say, 100 sectors or 100 routes, at right now, we can only do up to 42 routes, which have been mandated by the DGC. So it was actually 33% in June, and it has come to 42% now. So eventually, yes, it is increasing slowly, and it is coming back to its normal ways. But it will take time. It is not something which is, like I said, the mentality of the traveler, the thinking of the traveler has also changed, wherein we don't really want to... pay for vacation anymore, because we're no longer going on vacations. We're primarily going for business travels, but it is definitely getting better, and we hope for the best. So yes, I hope that answers your question. Any upper age, it depends from role to role. So for example, if it's a cabin crew, there is a certain age limit. If it's a newcomer, there is an age limit of 18 to 25 years of age. But if it is somebody who's an experienced cabin crew, could probably be a little higher age. If it's a pilot, again, there is a certain age limit. So for each of these roles, there is an age limit. And normally, when a particular, when the HR team of the aviation organization puts up these ads, they always put up these age limits that, okay, only person from this particular age to this particular age can apply. So it depends on each role. There is no, I mean, I cannot say that there is an upper age for, there's a common upper age for all roles. It is very specific. That's how it is. Why airlines are not paying pilots? I cannot give you a very, clear cut answer to that. But from what I understand is, think about it. I mean, if you are not getting, what is the main way that the airline earns its money? The airline earns its money by passengers paying the money for the tickets, by decreasing the operating costs, like I spoke to you about in the presentation. And getting that kind of revenue, right? Now, what has happened after COVID-19? I'm assuming you're asking this question, that why are they not paying the pilots after COVID-19? Otherwise, they pay the pilots. It's not like that they don't pay money to the pilots. So if you were to look at, so now think of it in this way. The revenue that I'm getting from the passengers is not coming to me, right? Because there is no flying and the flying has reduced. And my operating costs have increased because I still have to maintain the aircraft. It's not like that just because the aircraft is not flying, I don't really need to maintain the aircraft. I still have to maintain the aircraft. So my maintenance cost still remains. So my money is not coming in, but the inflow is not there, but the outflow is happening. So obviously I'm left with very little amount of cash in my hand. Now with that limited amount of cash, there are two options. Either we start saying that, okay, I don't need so many pilots or I don't need so many employees. So I start removing the pilots. I start, giving them the pink slips. Or what do? Is I do a salary cut across the organization so that everybody goes through it and everybody gets a cut so that everybody's job stays stable. So it is both ways. So some airlines look at it in a different way. Some airlines say that, okay, let's just, keep only the basic minimal requirement and remove the rest of the employees. Some have asked for pay cuts for all across the organization. So it could be any of these reasons. So most of these, they have to do this in order to sustain. So you have to understand that for an airline to sustain, there has to be a certain level of cash that has to be there, right? So that is the reason they're doing it, yeah? Then what is the retirement age for pilots? Well, retirement age for pilots is, if I'm not wrong, it's 56 or 60. It is somewhere between 56 to 60. I think if I'm not wrong, the retirement age is 60. Yeah.
What's the even it is 65 in some countries.
Exactly. Yes. It's 65 in some of the countries, but I think with the DGCA, it's 60. But yes, you're right. It is between 60 to 65. So yeah. Then what else? What other question do we have? What is the eligibility to work in operations? Well, like I mentioned, I have given you like I told you about the operations team in my presentation. Eligibility, if it is an engineer, if it's an AME or if it's a flight dispatcher, there are courses that you have to do. But in case you want to, let's say, work into a flight operations training team, or if you want to work into a licensing team or a normal operations team, your basic graduation is sufficient, right? You have that suffices. If you have a little bit of a working knowledge of the aviation industry, and if you are interested in the aircraft or in the aviation industry with a graduation degree, that actually suffices, and that's more than enough. However, it always helps if you intern in these organizations. So give some time. A lot of times, even when you're doing the course, diploma courses, or if let's say you're doing a BBA in aviation management, in your summer schedules or in your time off, intern with an aviation organization and tell the HR teams. You can approach the HR teams. A lot of times the HR teams themselves encourage interns to come into the organization, and they will ask you your preference. So you can always think about, what is it that you want to do? Do you want to learn about flight operations training? Do you want to learn about training of pilots and cabin crew? Do you want to learn about licensing bit? Do you want to learn about how the day-to-day operations happens in an organization? So I would always recommend that, even though, yes, the qualification requirement is just that of a graduate, but at the same time, I would also recommend that you should intern in these organizations to get that knowledge, because it's a very, very vast scope, and there are a lot of things to learn when it comes to the aviation teams, right? Any idea about Jet Airways coming back and start hiring? No, I have no idea. That is something that I have no clue about. Why aviation HR are very smart and very well-groomed? So Ruchi, I'll ask you this question. Why do you think they are very smart and well-groomed? You can write in the chat, or you can probably unmute yourself and say, why do you think why do you think they're very smart? Anything that you can think of, you can write it in the chat as well. No, I'm sure you're curious. So what do you think why do you think they're very smart, and why do you think they're so well-groomed all the time? So let me ask you this question. Do you think, would you go to a makeup artist who does not, who probably does not know how to do makeup on her own self, or who looks very shabby? A makeup artist who looks very shabby and who does not have any information of the makeup, right? It's a very normal thing, right? When you look at a particular role, you expect that role to speak for itself, right? Similarly, in case of somebody was saying something, I kind of missed. So we'll come back to your question as well. Whenever the next person can speak after I try and explain it to Ruchi. So just as like I said, so whenever there is a particular role that we are looking for, we want to ensure that that particular person speaks the role, right? So if you want to look at the aviation industry personnel, whether it is cabin crew, whether it is a ground staff, if the person himself or herself does not look smart and does not have good communication skills, would you be interested, or would you think highly of that airline? No. The whole airline industry, you have to understand at the end of it, is a hospitality industry. It is a hospitality industry wherein we look at, serving customers. We, like the hotel industry, we are looking at serving customers. You don't want to go to a hotel or a five-star hotel where the receptionist is looking, is in her pajamas, or who is probably not even well groomed, or is not smart, or who can't speak very well. Similar is the case with regards to an aviation industry where obviously you want to be well groomed. So a lot of effort is taken in order to groom them. A lot of effort is taken to train them as well, right? So in fact, a person who is a cabin crew, on another note, I can also say that when a person is a cabin crew with an airline, let's say they don't want to become, or they don't want to continue with the role of a cabin crew anymore. A lot of them become trainers. They become service trainers. They become safety trainers. A lot of them become grooming managers, because those are roles also which are important and are required in the aviation industry. Okay. I hope that answers your question. Is there any... great, Tanmay, I'll come back to your question. I'll just finish the questions in the chat and then we'll come back to you, yeah? Is there any hope that airlines will come back to its normal or do better than that in 2021, or will it take more time? Definitely, I think it will take more time. I don't think it will be that easy, and that's my opinion. And from what I have read in various airline publications, etc., most of them say that things, for everything to come back to its normal state, the way it was in 2019 or the way it was before the COVID, it will take at least a certain amount of time. And most of them say it's not before March 2023. So I don't think it will be completely back to normal as it was in 2021. Tanmay, sorry, please go ahead and ask your question. You're on mute, Tanmay.
Ma'am, my question is that you told that you have to look smart who works in the aviation industry. Yes. But in the some cases, international and national, ma'am, cases that services are not good and they behave rudely also from to frequent flyers. Ma'am, yes. My question is that if there is an improvement from them?
Surely. So... So I will, so to answer your question, firstly, yes, in international airlines, there are, in fact, not only international, in most of the, in I would say even domestic at times, and everywhere in the place, there are people who will have a certain amount of rudeness, as you say, right? You may come across as somebody who's rude. But that does not, that doesn't speak for the entire airline, for sure. It's like, for example, in a customer service, in a call center, right? In a call center, what happens is that all of them are supposed to speak to you in a very particular manner and in a professional manner. But there will be this one person who probably has, you know, maybe has had a bad day, or maybe has done something which is, you know, he or she's so fed up, and he turns and speaks to you in a particular way, which you probably won't like. But that doesn't mean that the ethics of the call center is that you can go ahead and speak like that. So similarly, in the aviation industry, the ethics don't permit you to speak in that particular way. So your entry level has to be that you have to be smart. Your entry level has to be that you have to have good communication skills, and you have to have that hospitality. That is your entry level requirement. Once you're in it, yes, it is up to you and your attitude, how you take things. Now, yes, a lot of times there may be people who behave in that particular way, and a lot of customers put in feedback as well, right? So there is feedback. Let me assure you, so especially in today's day and age, the social media has become a very powerful platform.
Yes, ma'am.
Times when they put it in the social media, right? They put that, okay, this particular staff was this bad or whatever. The PR teams, which I spoke about in my previous presentation, the PR teams are the ones who picks up these feedback from the social media. And there is a customer service team that actually looks at each and every of these comments and follows up on it. So, so yes, it is important. So even though there are people like that, they're taken very seriously in the aviation industry. And in fact, I would think in any hospitality industry. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. Yeah, you're still on mute. You're again on mute.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Ma'am, one question is that my friend who is living in Mumbai is traveling from Indore to Mumbai. He told that the service of SpiceJet is not good, ma'am. So my question is that if the services and facilities are not good, then they have to improve also. And ma'am, and you told that social media is a powerful tool, but some people use it in a wrong manner. So it is not good, yes, ma'am.
Correct. You're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. They don't use it in a right way. But be assured that all this is recorded. Be assured that all of this is followed up on. And if there is a particular person who has been complained against, there is action taken against them.
Okay.
So be rest assured about that. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome. You're welcome. Okay. So I think we are done with the questions. Any questions? So, Sakshi or anyone else wants to take it forward from here?
Ma'am, I think all has cleared their doubts.
Great. Great. So thank you guys. Thank you very much. And I hope this was an informative session, and I hope you guys could take something home from this session. And yeah. So there's another question. This is the retirement age is for all. I hope. Yes, that's right. The retirement age is definitely for all. It's not just for pilots and cabin crew, but it is for all of them. Yes. Right. Great. So thank you very much for this, for your time. And I am glad that you guys could all meet. And should there be any questions, you can get in touch with the Aircrew Aviation. Yeah. Thank you.
One second, ma'am. I would like to express my sincere thanks to you, Ms. Kirti Vilori. It was a pleasure to listen to you. I am sure that all have gained some insights from this productive webinar, and all have gained some insights about what are the different departments of job in aviation industry. So again, thank you so much for giving your important time. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.